Heather, who's going to do our step.
Dipshit. What's up, family? I'm Cameron. I'm a drug addict. So I'm sure a lot of you noticed that there's something different. Becky's not here tonight, obviously. What? You thought I was going to tell you why I'm up here looking like fucking riffraff? There's no story behind it. So, as you see, I do not have a big book. We're short in here tonight, which means people probably heard that Becky wasn't coming, and not a lot of people want to listen to me talk for an hour, I get it. So I'm going to, tell you my story. I'm going to intertwine a bunch of different stuff in it. I don't want to move forward in the step, the big book study without her. Anyone first time in this meeting? Few people, welcome guys. Typically this is we go through the big book line by line, word by word, and break it down for you. You'll hear it in my story, but I came in and I was in the rooms of Alcoholics Anonymous, I was in the rooms of Cocaine Anonymous for a while, and I just couldn't stay sober, man. I couldn't figure it out. I came in and out and I thought this is cool, going to these meetings and stuff, that's what they want me to do, that's what the treatment center told me to do, it's going to keep me sober. And the fact was is it didn't. I found myself high repeatedly over and over and over again, and I couldn't figure out why. And it wasn't until some guys sat me down and, pulled me with a vision and brought that book of Alcoholics Anonymous to life that, I realized a bunch of things that were imperative in me being motivated to go through with the actual step process. So I come in rooms like this a lot, all the time. I work in a halfway house, a sober living environment, and I get the privilege or the opportunity to work with alcoholics and drug addicts on a daily basis. And I constantly, constantly, constantly see people pass away from this disease. And, when something like that happens, especially when it's somebody like a celebrity or like a famous person, it's so incredibly obvious to see the just a huge misunderstanding of alcoholics and drug addicts throughout the world. And I say this to all my sponsees because we'll go through the book and we'll talk about it. And someone that's not a drug addict or an alcoholic does not need to understand the disease of addiction. The people that are sitting in this room, it's important that we understand. And so it's nothing against them, but I see stuff constantly. One of the recent ones, Philip Seymour Hoffman, you would see on social media, how selfish he was. He made some poor life choices. How selfish of him to choose heroin or choose these drugs over his children, over his family, and leave behind these two little boys or whatever it is. I can understand the logic behind that for somebody that's not a real deal alcoholic. What's even stranger than that, though, is I hear it in these rooms. I hear people say, I just decided to get high. I make poor life choices. I relapsed again. I made a decision to go out and get high. I don't know about you guys, but I'm very, very clear on the fact that that's not a matter of choice for me. If I had the power to just not shoot dope, I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you guys. I wouldn't need to. The fact is usually when I see that, and I was brought up in a sponsorship family, as a lot of you guys know, or you'll hear in my story, that you go to a meeting and you watch to see who picks up the white chip and you talk to that person after the meeting. I would be sitting in IOP and I'd hear people say oh, I keep relapsing and I keep relapsing, and I'd go up to them and I'd talk to them and I'd be like, can I ask you a couple questions? And they'd be like, sure, Cam, go ahead. And I'd ask them did you have a sponsor? Did you work the 12 steps and have a spiritual awakening as a result of the steps? Well, no. Okay, well, did you have a home group and a commitment that you attended weekly? Well, no. I'm wondering okay, well, what did you relapse from exactly? Because a relapse is defined as falling back into an old pattern or behavior. A lot of times people come in and out, and if I fully understand the disease concept and I understand that I do not have the power of choice in shooting dope or smoking crack, and that I will 100% walk out of this room and, short of a spiritual experience, get high again. If I truly understand that, and I come into my cute little halfway house in fucking Section 8 housing, and I'm chilling there, and I'm not doing any work, I'm not going to get better. I am eventually going to get high again. And I didn't get that. I didn't get that. And I thought that I was a chronic relapser, but the fact is I had never done any work. The obsession to drink and use had not been removed from my life, so how would it be possible for me to fall back into an old pattern or behavior? It wasn't. And it was just a verbiage thing, and it was one of those things that's just commonly misused, but it was important for me to understand that, because now when I hear somebody say that hasn't been through any of the work, chances are they don't even know what it means to be an alcoholic. So especially in a meeting like this, I know a lot of treatment center vans come here. We have a lot of people in and out. We have a bunch of people that also come consistently. But I feel like I'm doing a disservice if I do not talk about this when I speak from the podium. And because it was the thing for me that changed the game. You know, like I said before, I was in the rooms of Alcoholics Anonymous. I was in the rooms of Cocaine Anonymous. I could not figure out how to get sober. And the reason was is, one, I didn't understand the first step. But two, I didn't understand what it meant to be an alcoholic. I could walk into a room much like this one, and I could raise my hand, and I could say, hey, guys, I'm Cameron. I'm an alcoholic. And I could share some shit that would sound good to somebody that has no idea what they're talking about. But it wasn't accurate. It wasn't accurate. And it wasn't until I sat down and was taken through that and fully understood that I made some progress into the actual program of Alcoholics Anonymous. So I feel like this is very, very important. My sobriety date is July 6, 2013. I have a sponsor who has a sponsor. I have sponsees that have sponsees. That's all cool, and we use that in a sense to qualify ourselves from the podium. But that does not qualify me as an alcoholic or a drug addict. You know, the first thing I want to talk about is I'm a real deal drug addict, alcoholic, because I have an obsession of the mind. You know, I have this idea that pops into my head, and what it essentially does is it convinces me that it will be okay, despite all of my evidence that shows otherwise, that it'll be okay to get high just one more time. You know, I have what we call it the mental obsession. And an obsession is a thought that is so powerful that it crowds out all other thoughts so that no thought can coexist while that thought is present. So, you know, we talk about it in the book. In the doctor's opinion, it talks about an inability to differentiate the true from the false. Later, it's going to talk about a lack of perception. Perception is my ability to assess a situation based on what I see, what I hear, what I touch, what I feel, all of the above. And then a lack of proportion, you know, size. So when we talk about the mental obsession, the easiest way to talk about it is it's the lie that we tell ourselves. Anyone in here ever thought, has anyone here been trying to get sober for a while? I know I have. And found, you know, you come in and you have this honest desire to stop. Like, you don't want to shoot crack anymore. It's stopped being fun for, a period of time already. And you come in and you make a resolution like, hey, I'm not going to smoke crack anymore. Seems like a pretty good idea. And then found yourself high again. And for the life of me, cannot figure out why that is. And what it is, man, it's that inability to tell what's real and not real. So, like, I'm a 20-some-year-old kid, and I went to Penn State, and I'm laying in bed, and I do not want to shoot dope anymore. Like I said, it had stopped being fun for a long time now. And I'm in bed in the morning, and I'm going through a mental list of consequences of why I'm not going to shoot dope that day. And I'm like, if I shoot dope today, if I get high today, I'll get kicked off the team, I'll get kicked out of college, I'll lose my place to live, the girl's going to leave, I'm on probation, so if I piss in a cup, I'm going away for a while. And what I do is I lay in bed and I make a decision based on those facts that I'm not going to get high that day. Easiest kind of decision to make. And then what happens to me is, you know, I get out of bed and about 10 seconds later, another thought pops into my head. And that thought's like, well, you could have just one. You could have just one. And my brain locks on this idea of I could have just one. And the scary thing about being an alcoholic and a drug addict is all of those true things that I just thought about in my head never come back to my mind. For the reason that I'm just going to have one. You know, it's going to be different this time, and here's how. And, you know, I'm an alcoholic, I'm an addict. Like, I've never in my entire life had one of just, you know, if I like something, I'm having a lot of it, probably as much of it as I can get. So, you know, this thought that, like, oh, I'm only going to do one is a lie. You know, it's, there's so many ways to explain it, man. And, like, my experience, and I'll layer this all out over my story, but, like, so many times I've had an honest desire to stop and meant it as much as I mean it, sitting here tonight telling all of you, like, I never, ever want to smoke crack again. I mean that. I could pass a lie detector test. But countless times, this thought would come in, like, fuck it, I just don't care. And I'd go on a run. What I can promise all of you is that if you are a real deal alcoholic, you will never, ever go out on the truth. Anyone else gone out on the fuck it's? When you got back from your run, you know, did you care? We usually do. You know, after I burn my entire fucking life to the ground and I come into a treatment center in sunny South Florida, I usually care. Well, I'll get there. The second part of it is, like, this physical allergy. You know, Dr. Silkworth, in the doctor's opinion, suggests this idea that I react differently than normal people to heroin, to crack, to alcohol, to kratom, to flocka, to bath salts. I mean, you name it. I have a reaction that's different. Maybe some of you guys can relate to this, you know. What the book talks about is a phenomenon of craving. You know, I put one bag of dope in my system, and that next bag of dope becomes more important than my family. It becomes more important than the relationship. It becomes more important than having a roof over my head. It becomes more important than the job. All these things. So, like, anyone here got kids? Has that ever been a sufficient enough reason for you to stop shooting dope? You know, I'm standing in front of the dope man, and I'm completely sober, and I'm there with my little sister, who a lot of you guys have met her. I absolutely love her. Probably, you know, one of the most favorite people in my life. I'm absolutely blessed to be a part of her life today. And I'm standing there with the dope man. The dope man's like, hey, man, I'm completely sober. No drugs or alcohol in my system. He's like, hey, man, you can have this hit of crack, but you're never going to see your sister again. No deal, man. Like, no deal. Absolutely not. It's a stupid idea. You put a hit of crack in my system and give me that same exact offer, give me the hit. Give me the hit. I will justify until next year as to why I will not see my sister again. But the fact is I put that one in my system and I lose all control over how much I'm going to do. You know, the way I explain this to my mother, who's not one of us, you know, she's one of the people that can like order wine and take a sip of it and be like, I'm good. I don't want the rest of this. Like, it doesn't even make sense to a guy like me. But like the way I'd explain it is next time you go swimming, dive in the pool, stay underwater until you feel like you're about to pass out. And then stay underwater for another like 10, 15 seconds. I promise you that the only thing that you will be thinking about is that next breath. It's the only thing you'll be thinking about. And you will do whatever you have to do to get it. It's the same thing when I put a hit of crack in my system. So like, sorry, mom, if your bank account comes between me and that next breath, like, it's not personal. It's not personal. And they don't get that. I have to have that next one. So the book asks two questions. And like, I'm going to mix a little bit of anyone that's heard me do that's not in the book. I'm going to do some of that tonight too. Like, there are two first step questions. I don't need you to write me or to fill out a 150-page fucking packet on the first step because there's two questions. There's no work done in 1 through 3. You will not put pen to paper. Most of us have done 1 through 3 while we were out using. We just need to gather the information and intellectualize and internalize that so that I can see like, okay, that's right. I'm fucked. I get it. Like all that stuff. There's no work done. There's two questions and you can ask yourself them right now. The first question is when you drink, when you shoot crack, when you eat flock of gummy bears, can you control how much that you do? Can you control how much that you do every time that you use them? For me, the answer is no, I can't. You know, there's been countless times where I'm in, you know, Paterson, New Jersey, or Kensington, or wherever it is, and I've got, you know, 20 bags of dope, and I'm like, hey, I'm saving 5 of these for tomorrow morning so I'm not sick. And then, like, 2 o'clock rolls around, and I'm like, well, I could do, like, 2 of these, and I'll still have 3 for tomorrow morning. And then it's, like, 3:30, and I'm like, well, I might as well just get fucked up tonight and I'll just worry about that tomorrow because it's not going to do anything for me in the morning. And next thing you know, they're all gone. You know, when I put something in my system, I cannot control how much that I do. So many times I've said, hey, I'm going to go out and have 2 beers and drink socially with my friends and, you know, woke up 3 days later, you know, in a fucking coma. It just doesn't work for me. There might be occasions where you could control your drinking. You know, maybe my girlfriend who doesn't exist is like, hey, you go out and, you know, if you don't get too drunk tonight, I'll sleep with you. And I'm like, okay, cool, you got a deal. And I go out and I might have 2 beers. What I can promise you is 2 things. One, I cannot control and enjoy my drinking. Second is that when she gives me that same offer, like a couple days later, like no deal. I'm drinking until I get the effect that I want and then I'm drinking way past that. So the first question, can you control how much you use, when you use, every time you use? Second question is about the mental obsession. You know, the issue is not the allergy. If you're sitting in here and you're detoxed from drugs and alcohol and if you do not have anything in your system, you do not have a phenomenon of craving. What you have is a mental obsession. Anyone that's allergic to anything, a lot of you guys have heard my story, you know I'm allergic to peaches. What happened is I ate peaches, I broke out in hives, and I just don't eat peaches anymore. Like, it's real, real simple. Fact is I shoot heroin, I rob my mother, I have all these shitty consequences, and I cannot stop shooting heroin. I just don't get it. It's because I don't have a mental obsession for peaches. I'm not going to be a hotel on Federal mixing up fucking peach smoothies tonight, thinking like, oh, it's going to be okay this time. It's not going to happen. So, the question for the obsession is, have I ever wanted to stop and not been able to? You know, the countless times, like I said, I tried everything I possibly could to stop shooting dope before coming to Cocaine Anonymous. Absolutely. You know, this was a last resort for me. Nobody comes here on a winning streak. I don't think anyone was sitting at their house today, scratching off lottery tickets, won $100 million, and was like, hey, I'm going to go check out what's going on at the 101 Club tonight. It doesn't happen. I heard Riff Raff speaking. Like, it doesn't it doesn't happen, man. We don't come into Cocaine Anonymous on a winning streak. We come in absolutely broken. Spiritually speaking, and usually circumstantially speaking, although the circumstances are not relevant at all. And what I mean by that is this, is like, I say it all the time, it does not matter if your bottom is like shooting dope behind the dumpster in Kensington or if it's spilling champagne in your Bentley, it's 100% irrelevant. We all come to some sort of spiritual bankruptcy that brings us into the rooms. And the reason that I talk about that is so many people have a complete misunderstanding of the first step that they don't get that. And a billionaire walks through this door into the room of Cocaine Anonymous and does not feel welcome. And they do not relate to what we're talking about because she's not powerless. She's got millions of dollars. She has people do things for her. Her life's not unmanageable in the sense that we talk about in the rooms. So the first step, like, on the wall is cool. You know, I'm powerless. My life's unmanageable. Okay. What the book says is that I need to fully concede to my innermost self that I'm an alcoholic. This is the first step in recovery. Like we just did, like, how can I possibly concede, surrender to my heart and to my head that I'm a real deal alcoholic if I don't understand what that means? If I don't understand that I have this obsession of the mind, this allergy of the body, and this spiritual malady. If I don't get that, I could not possibly concede that that's what I am. And I could not possibly layer my story over that and look back and see it. So I wouldn't understand, like, okay, I'm powerless in the sense that I lack the power of choice in drink. Lack of power, that's my dilemma. I wouldn't understand that my life is unmanageable. You know, I think it's unmanageable because I lost a job and I, you know, lost 55 girlfriends and I, you know, burned my house down and I, whatever, all this crazy stuff, pissed the bed. And it's like, that doesn't necessarily mean that my life's unmanageable. It could just mean I'm a fuck up. The unmanageability that we're talking about is that when I put down heroin and I put down crack, my life gets worse. I become irritable, restless, and discontented. And unless I can shoot dope or smoke crack again and get that effect that I'm looking for, my life gets worse. Yeah, and if you can relate to that, you probably belong here. You know, if you've walked into a room completely sober and there's two or three people in the corner laughing and you're like, they're definitely talking shit about me. You know, like a couple weeks ago, I got a phone call from my boss and I was like napping or something, so I didn't answer it. And he left me a 3-minute voicemail. It was obviously a butt dial, but I will be damned if I didn't sit there and listen to that voicemail 2 times through to make sure he wasn't talking about me. The fact that you guys are laughing indicates a massive problem in your life. And that's the part that we don't talk about enough in the rooms, like this spiritual malady. You know, all the external unmanageability, and Bill Wilson said it, you know, it was by our circumstances, not our virtues, that we saw change. Usually I see the circumstances first. I understand, like, okay, I'm homeless, no one wants to talk to me, I don't have any money, I should probably go to treatment and get help. Like, we usually see that first. But all that is like a reflection of however I'm treating this internal condition. You know, internally, like, I just don't feel okay. That's my problem. Like, I wake up sober in the morning and, like, the voices are already going in my head and they're like, hey, Cam, nice you to join us today. We got a lot to think about. You know, like, you're very underappreciated at the workplace. Your girlfriend's probably going to leave you today. All this stuff just going crazy in my head. And eventually what happens is I need relief from that. And how does a kid like me know how to get relief? Usually through a needle or, you know, a pipe or whatever, you know, look at it yourself. But that spiritual malady, man, I am not okay with who I am. We talk about it as a disconnect from God, self, and others. You know, it's the reason I can sit in a room like this with however many people and still not feel a part of, still feel completely alone. And so let me, like, I want to lay out the cycle for you real quick. Like I said, this is very important, and then I'll brush through my story, which isn't that important. So the analogy that I like is, like, I'm in a relationship, and she's absolutely sick of me using. She's done. And I'm like, listen, like, I don't want to do this anymore. I'm going to stop, like, for the relationship, for us. Like, I'm done doing this. And I mean it. I mean it. And what happens is I put down the heroin, and I'm going through the week, and like I said, I become irritable, restless, and discontented. And we're arguing over stupid shit, and, like, she's texting. Like, she's definitely texting some other guy. And what happens is Friday rolls around, and this chaos in my head, and, you know, my paycheck gets deposited. And I think to myself, like, okay, I'm a heroin addict. Like, I could go out to the bar with my boys and shoot some pool, and I'm not going to drink. It's not going to be an issue for me. And what happens is I get to the bar, and this thought comes. That obsession hits, and the thought is like, well, you know what? You could have one beer. You know, she's not going to know. You earned it. You haven't shot dope all week, which is pretty cool. And you'll get some relief going on from this chaos in your head. And I'm like, you know what? That's a good idea. Because I have an inability to differentiate the true from the false. I cannot tell what's real and not real. So that thought appears to be a good idea to me. And all of you can sit there and look at it and think, like, that's absolutely ridiculous. Like, why would you be able to have one beer? You're an alcoholic. But in my own perception, I don't see that. I don't see that. I see some guy walking down the street and he's talking to himself, and I can look at that and be like, he's probably not all there upstairs. But in his own perception, do you think that he thinks that? Probably not. That's me when the lie comes into my mind. And what happens is I have that one beer, and then my experience is I'll have one or two more beers, and then I'm going to the ATM, and I'm going to the hood to meet Julio, and I'll come home 3 days later, And if she's there, she's pissed, obviously. And we're alcoholics, we're drug addicts, we can be pretty persuading when we need to be. And I'm like, listen, baby, like, give me one more chance. I know how I fucked up. I don't want to do this anymore. I'm done. And maybe she gives me another chance. And what happens? I put down the drugs and alcohol, and I just don't feel okay. And when Friday rolls around, paycheck gets deposited, thought comes. You know, last week I got in trouble because I went out to the bar. This week, if I just get, you know, a couple bottles of Robitussin from the gas station, drink those down, she's not going to know. It's going to be okay. And what happens is I go to the gas station, and while I'm there, I see Julio, and I'm like, fuck the Robitussin. And I come home 6 days later, and she's gone. Can anyone in here relate to that cycle? Well, my sponsor sat me down, and he showed me that. And what the book says is that this is repeated over and over. So essentially what that says and what my experience shows is that I stayed stuck in that cycle over and over where I wanted to stop and then the thought came and I picked up again, and as I succumbed to the desire again, as I always do, the phenomenon of craving developed and I went on a run. And then I came back with a firm resolution to never smoke crack again and did it over and over and over. My sponsor looked me in the eyes and said, listen, dude, like, you are fucked. He said, when I ask you what your understanding of the first step is, that's what I want you to tell me, that you're fucked. I don't want to hear that you're powerless and your life's unmanageable. I want to hear that you will 100%, short of a spiritual experience, walk out of this room and smoke crack again, which my experience shows abundantly, but for some reason I couldn't see it until that information was laid out in front of me. And that's the first step, man. Like, I'm fucked, and not only am I fucked, but I do not possess the power to unfuck myself. And then, once we understand that, we're left with two options. One is I can go experiment with that myself. You know, maybe I take the lackadaisical approach and I go out and do what we do, man. I do what we do. And I can promise all of you, it sucks to be out there knowing, like, that's the lie I went out on. To be out doing shit that you don't want to do to get drugs that aren't going to satisfy a craving anyway, it's a terrible place to be. It's a terrible place to be. And it brings people's bottoms up to them very rapidly. The other option is that understanding that information and internalizing it will motivate you to do steps 2 through 12. Because the very next line after that, where it says, this is repeated over and over, says, and unless this person can experience an entire psychic change, there is very little hope of their recovery. So how do I experience an entire psychic change? First of all, what is an entire psychic change? I didn't come into the rooms of Cocaine Anonymous knowing what that meant. I had a sponsor that sat me down and showed me. And all that it is and all it says in the book is that it's a personality change strong enough to bring about and maintain recovery. So the way that I see that is like, the way that I view people, the way that I see things, the way that I treat people, my concepts, my ideas, these things going on in my head are cast to one side and replaced with an entirely new set of concepts. Sounds crazy. How do I obtain that? It's promised in the 12th step. Having had a spiritual experience as a result of these steps, you know, we try to carry this message to other people. It's promised. It doesn't say, if perhaps by this point you've had a spiritual experience, then maybe you can continue and do this. The fact is, like, it's promised there. And never once have I met somebody that came into the rooms of Cocaine Anonymous and thoroughly and honestly went through the 12 steps and did not have a spiritual experience. I've never seen it. On the flip side of that, never once have I seen a real deal alcoholic come into the rooms of Cocaine Anonymous and not do the steps and stay sane, sober, or happy for any appreciable length of time. I've never seen it. You know, there is one solution for this internal condition that I just talked about for me, and that is a spiritual experience as a result of the steps is outlined in the book, period. Period. You know, it doesn't matter. I could attend every single meeting in South Florida for the next year, and I promise you, if I did not go through the step process, I would not stay sober. Cocaine Anonymous is not about meeting attendance. It's not. You know, I'll get into it. I guess I should tell you guys a little bit about my story. I'm going to run through the war story aspect of it. Like, you guys all get it. Essentially, what happened is I would set boundaries for myself, and given the first opportunity, I'd run right past those boundaries like it didn't exist, and I would just set my boundary a little bit further. You know, I'm only going to drink. I'm not going to smoke weed. Next thing you know, I'm smoking weed. Never doing coke. Next thing you know, I got a needle in my arm. You guys all know how it goes. What I will talk about, though, is the things that everybody can relate to, regardless of the circumstances. Like, when I was a kid, I don't know if I had an obsession. I don't know if I had an allergy. What I do know is, like, the spiritual malady was very, very, you know, present in my life. Like, I just didn't feel like I belonged. Bill Wilson talks about maladjusted to life, and I can absolutely identify with that. There was this underlying nervousness that I couldn't pinpoint or I couldn't, you know, articulate to anybody. I just knew it was there. And, like, I would do whatever I could to be a part of the people who were around me. So, like, it didn't matter who I was, who I was around, like, that's what I would do to fit in. If I was with the guys playing baseball, I'd do that. If I was with the guys, you know, all that different stuff. And the fact is, like, I was sold on this American dream that if only I got with the right crowd, if only I was the popular kid in high school, if only I got the right girl, the right job, the right money, the right, all that stuff, that, like, I would be happy. I would be cool. My circumstances would be better. I would be better internally. And what eventually happened is, you know, I acquired some of those things and I found out, like, that wasn't the case. So anyway, fast forward, man, you know, I'm homeless. I'm living in my car. It's like, you know, it's a decent car, makes a real shitty house. And, you know, the idea to go to treatment comes up. And I was always the drug addict that was like, I'm never going to be one of those dudes that goes to rehab. I will stop before it gets to that point. When it gets too bad, I'll stop. And, yeah, we all know, like, by the time I want to stop, I've lost the ability to do so. Again, if I had the power to stop drinking or smoking crack on my own, I would not be sitting here. I wouldn't need to. So I go into treatment, and nice little state-run facility in Pennsylvania. And while I'm there, like, I go, the first time I go, I AMA, like, 3 hours later. Come back a week later, and I'm in there. And, like, I still don't really want to get sober. Like, the fact is, like, I just wanted to build back enough trust that I could go on another run. Because that's all I knew. Like, my experience with getting sober was, like, when you take the heroin away from me, my life gets worse. Like, I get worse. So why the fuck would the idea of stopping, like, be my own? Like, my own decision? It just didn't make sense to a guy like me. While I was in detox, though, you know, we call them those little God moments. You know, we live our lives forward, but we view them backwards, especially in the spiritual sense. And, like, let me assure all of you guys that the only reason that I'm sitting here or sitting anywhere else is because I have a relationship with a God that does for me what I could never do for myself. Short of that, like, I can promise all of you, I would have destroyed my life years ago. So I never want to leave that God factor out of this. And we'll talk, you know, anyone that comes this consistently, like, we talk about it all the time. If you're sitting in here and you don't believe in God, like, that's absolutely cool. It's not a requirement. It's not a requirement. I came in early on and my sponsor was like, dude, get off the debate team. Like, all I'm asking you to do is take some actions, regardless of how you feel, and see what happens. See what happens. This is a program of action, and that's exactly what I did. And as a result of that action, I had an experience with whatever it is that you want to call the power that's greater than yourself. I choose to call it God. But when I sit up here and I say, God, just please know I have no idea what I'm talking about. You know, it's an experience. It's not like something that I can understand with my mind, or it's not something that I could articulate to you guys. Like, I just couldn't do it. And if you haven't had that experience with a power greater than yourself, then you're probably not going to know what I'm talking about. I could sit here and talk for 3 hours, and, like, if you haven't done the work and had that happen to you, you're not going to get it. So while I'm in there, like, something changes, and I'm like, okay, I'm gonna do what these people tell me to do. I don't know if I want what they have. I just know I sure as shit don't want what I have anymore. And they take me to my first AA meeting while I'm up in Pennsylvania. Anyone been to AA meetings up north? It's a lot different. Definitely don't talk about crack while you're up there. But I walk into this old, you know, AA meeting, and keep in mind, like, my perception's all fucked up at the time. I'm in a detox, obviously. And I walk into this meeting, and it's a bunch of old dudes, and they're sitting there with their arms crossed, and they're mean mugging the shit out of me, and they're like, if you want what we have, you'll do what we did. And, like, I didn't really want what they had, so needless to say, like, I didn't do what they did. And I'm like, I'm good, guys, I'm good. And what happens is things line up perfectly for me to come down to South Florida. Now, keep in mind, I still have this belief that if only I get the right girl, the right job, the right all this stuff, like, I'll feel better. So how could, you know, coming down to South Florida and hashtag living where everybody else vacations and, like, all that good stuff not make me feel better? And what happens is I get down to South Florida and I do feel a little bit better. It's easier to feel better when you don't have a crack pipe in your mouth. When you don't have a needle hanging out of your neck, you're probably going to feel a little bit better. Maybe you get the nice little job in the phone room and you get yourself a nice little scooter and a girlfriend. You might feel a little bit better. But then what happens is it becomes not enough. And these thoughts start to come into my head, like, I'm 24 years old and I live in a fucking halfway house. Like, I went to Penn State, like, I had all these good jobs, like, what am I doing with my life? And I start to become very discontented with the things that for a very short period of time were making me happy. And when a guy like me gets discontented in this chaos in my head, what's my go-to thing? Heroin, or down here at Dilaudid's, or whatever it was at the time. And I get down here, and I walk I wanted to stop. Keep in mind, like, I did not want to use anymore, I was done using. And I walked 4 miles to a meeting from the halfway house I was at. And it was a noon meeting, and I get there, and again, keep in mind my perception's a little screwed up, but this little, I'll never forget it, this cute little old lady. I'm sitting in this meeting and I'm full of fear. Like, I don't know anybody. And like, I'm out of my element. And for a drug addict, like, that's how I feel all the time when I'm not shooting dope. Like, I'm full of fear. I don't know anyone. I'm uncomfortable. I don't feel good enough. I'm not a part of. All those things are going through my head. And this cute little old lady comes up to me after the meeting. And she looks me dead in the eyes and says, just don't drink and continue to come to these meetings and you'll be fine. And I'm standing there and I'm thinking, like, if I could just not drink, I wouldn't need to come to these meetings. I wouldn't need to, because I'd just be not drinking. You know, and I hear people say stuff like, no matter what, no matter what, don't pick up. You know, throw a few more no matter what's in there. It sounds cute. It sounds cool. But the fact is I can't do that. I'm the opposite of that. No matter what, no matter what, I will pick up. You know? Excuse me. If I could just no matter what, no matter what, don't pick up, I wouldn't be working the steps. I wouldn't be sitting here. I wouldn't answer my phone at 3 o'clock for a terrified newcomer because I wouldn't need to. I'd just be out doing my thing, you know, not picking up. The fact is that doesn't work for a kid like me. The idea of just put the plug in the jug or just go to meetings and don't pick up does not work for a kid like me. You know, I got the going to meetings part down really, really well. It's the whole not picking up thing that I seem to have an issue with. And people don't understand that. And what I think that comes from, and I don't want to get too far off topic, is a problem drinker compared to a real deal alcoholic. Somebody that can come into the rooms of Cocaine Anonymous and they can gym, tan, laundry, get themselves a girlfriend, and they start to feel better. I come in here, that stuff does not help me to feel better. That person, and they're welcome here. The only requirement for membership is a desire to stop smoking crack or any other mind-altering substances. They are welcome in the rooms. The issue that I have is that they do not need to do what I need to do to get sober. And what happens is they get a year, and somebody says, hey, you got a year, you should sponsor. And they start sponsoring, and they sponsor a kid like me, and I will die. I promise you, I will smoke crack again, because how could I possibly show somebody how to have a spiritual experience if I haven't had one? If I have not had one, I cannot possibly transmit that to some newcomer that cannot stop smoking crack. So the idea of sitting in the back of an AA meeting or a CA meeting and saying, yeah, just don't pick up. Just come to these meetings and don't pick up is absolutely ludicrous. Like I said before, the only thing that will treat this internal condition that I suffer from, like, I came in here and I remember what it was like to be new. You know, I didn't understand what Cocaine Anonymous or Alcoholics Anonymous was. And, like, there's meetings everywhere in South Florida. You can't swing a dead cat without hitting a drug addict down here. They're everywhere. There is tons of Alcoholics Anonymous literature. There is tons of Cocaine Anonymous literature. It's all great stuff. I didn't understand what that was. Those things are support mechanisms for my recovery. My recovery is the 12 steps as outlined in the first 164 pages of the Big Book, period. Those things are support mechanisms to that, not substitutes. Not substitutes. And like I say it all the time, if I walk over and I punch that window out and I cut an artery in my arm and I throw a towel over it and I run out to the car and I drive to the hospital and I get to the hospital and I run into the emergency room and I'm in there and I'm bleeding out all over the floor. And the doctor comes out and he's like, come on back, Mr. Carrot, we'll treat you now. And I'm like, nah, man, I'm good. I'm going to wait here. And I bleed to death in the emergency room. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the emergency room. I watch people that go to 2 to 3 meetings a day sit in here and die of untreated alcoholism, cannot stay sober on a bet, because what they don't understand is the 12 steps is the only thing we have to offer here. You know, we don't heal in the rooms of Cocaine Anonymous or Alcoholics Anonymous. We heal outside the rooms one-on-one with pairs. You know, the whole thing is in support of me sitting down one-on-one with another alcoholic, going from the man on the bed, the man on the bed to the man on the chair. That's what this is all about. And, what happened is I went to meetings for a while. I took that advice. I just didn't drink and went to meetings. And eventually I got high. I got high. And that wasn't anything like had to do with that lady. You know, she just didn't know any better. That's how she was brought up in the rooms of Cocaine Anonymous. And I didn't put in the work. I was going to solution-based meetings. I was going to meetings where they were talking about God. They were talking about the Big Book. I'm pretty sure I had a Big Book sponsor. But I got high again. I just wasn't ready to hear it. I wasn't hearing what people were telling me. And, you know, knowing the information and, like, understanding the steps and all that stuff is, like, really cool. But if I can't apply it to the outside areas of my life, it really doesn't matter. So, like, I'm going to these meetings where they're talking about God and doing all this stuff, and then I'm going to my job at this phone room and selling some 90-year-old lady Microsoft tech support that doesn't even fucking exist. I'm not going to be able to sleep okay at night. I'm not going to be able to sleep okay at night, because ripping off some little old lady does not apply with the principles or these steps that I'm trying to apply to my life. It doesn't work for a kid like me. It's the same thing if I sit up here at the podium and I talk to you guys and I walk outside and try to look for somebody that has insurance to come to my halfway house so I can headhunt them and get paid off them. When I start to look at addicts as dollar signs, there's a huge, huge issue. You know, the whole thing about Alcoholics Anonymous is it's about applying these things to my outside affairs. You know, it's about being able to do things I was never able to do before, like show up as a son to my mother, show up as an employee to the place that I work. You know, these things that I was never able to do. And just coming in here and, like, being spiritual while I'm at the podium is not good enough. It's not good enough to just be spiritual when I sit down one-on-one with a sponsee. You know, if my standard of success is that I just didn't smoke crack today, I should probably raise my standard. You know, I walk outside and I kick a midget and punch a nun in the face and take some old lady's purse and I'm like, yeah, well, I didn't smoke crack today. Thanks, guys. Like, raise your standard of success. That is not what Cocaine Anonymous is about. That's not what we're about. So anyway, what happens eventually is I go on another run. I go back home. There's a little miscommunication with my mom's bank account, and I come back down to South Florida. And a few of you guys got that. I come down to South Florida, and I get into treatment, and I do what we all do. And, you know, you've heard it a million times. I fall in love with some girl at the Medline. Listen, in my defense, she took Neurontin at the same time as me, so it was, like, meant to be. And we did what we all do, you know, we planned our lives together. She was from Jersey, I was from, you know, close to Philly, it worked out great. And we had this brilliant plan that we were going to go home, we were going to get a car, and we were going to come down here and get an apartment. Even though I had absolutely no money. But I couldn't let her know that, because my ego is just far, far too important at that point. And what eventually happens is, like, another one of those God moments, and I realize, like, you've done the same thing over and over and over again. Repeatedly. And it has not worked for you. And I wound up going to a halfway house down here, and I adamantly didn't want to because I thought I was too good for that. My last experience at halfway was just absolutely terrible. But I wound up at this halfway house, and some couple guys grabbed me, and they sat me down, and they took me to the doctor's opinion. The guy that I had sponsor me when I first got in the rooms was the guy that brought an H&I into the treatment center I was at, Dipshit. And I remember sitting there, and I can't remember what he said. I don't remember the information he portrayed, but I remember looking at him and understanding, like, this is a guy that gets exactly what I went through. And not only that, he's not smoking crack today. And I had tried everything to stop getting high and couldn't figure out why it was. And I went up and I talked to him, and luckily, like, he was sponsoring one of my brothers at the halfway house, and I was able to link up with him. And he sat down and he took me through the book. And he made the book come to life, man. You know, a lot of this stuff, like the information, the words and stuff, like, I don't get it. I tried to read it in treatment, and I had absolutely no idea what I was reading or talking about. I skipped to the personal stories of the NA book because I thought, like, that was, you know, I can relate to these guys. I get it. And I had no idea what it meant. I couldn't. No one had ever walked up to me and said, hey, Cam, like, she hit me with that frothy emotional appeal today. Like, nobody talks like that. It's not 1939 anymore. I needed someone that could sit down and show me how to relate to that. And show me that what frothy emotional appeal actually meant was, like, when I sit down across from my mother and she's like, why won't you just stop? You're destroying our family. Like, why can't you just stop? And I sit there and I'll tell her, like, oh, you're right, I'm done. You're right, I'm done. And then I'll walk away from that and get high again. Frothy emotional appeal, you know, froth, light, airy, there's not a lot of substance to it. Emotional appeal, something that touches my heart. Like my mom saying that, I absolutely love my mother. The last thing I would ever want to do is hurt her. Yet heroin took me to a place where that is all I continually did. Someone brought the book of Alcoholics Anonymous to life. They explained to me what I suffered from, the threefold disease that we just talked about, and I had that pop moment, we call it, where my head popped out of my ass and I realized, like, holy shit, I'm fucked. And I went through the rest of the work pretty quickly. I didn't have time, man. You know, I hear a lot of things like, wait a year to sponsor, and like, I'm really glad no one told Bill Wilson that, because none of us would be sitting here. Or things like, oh, we'll get you on a four-step in a year. Like, I did not have time for that. Like I said before, 1 through 3, there's no work. It's 2 conclusions and a decision. And the first time we take work in the program of Alcoholics Anonymous is when I put pen to paper on a four-step, and I start writing, and I start looking at my inventory, and I set aside the wrongs others have done to me, and I resolutely look for my own mistake. And I went through that process rapidly. You know, I did not have time. You know, there might be I see some alcoholics that come in and they got a few years and they have some time and they haven't done much work and they're not very happy, joyous, and free. But, like, a kid coming off a crack pipe into the rooms of Cocaine Anonymous does not have anything like a year to get into the work. I've seen it repeatedly. That was me. You know, if I didn't come in and I didn't go through that process that's going to free me from the obsession to drink rapidly, I wasn't staying. I wasn't staying, and thank God that he did that for me. And what he did immediately after that is he took me through the doctor's opinion. I'm like 3 days, there's 33 days sober because I'm out of treatment. And he's like, what I want you to do is I want you to take that kid through the doctor's opinion tonight. And I was like, no, I'm not doing that. I have nothing to offer him. I can't do it. He's like, you're giving yourself too much credit. It's not for him. It's for you. Take him through the doctor's opinion. And I did that. And I continued to do that. You know, I believe that what Cocaine Anonymous, 90% of what Cocaine Anonymous comes from the 12th step. You know, the first 11 steps will give me 10% of what's offered here. The other 90 will come from the 12th step. And that's my experience as well. You know, like I went through the steps pretty rapidly. A lot of you heard my story. Like what happened is I'm sponsoring 95 guys. I've got 4-step packets on deck. I'm having big book studies everywhere. And I just start to be run over by ego because that's like what a kid like me does. You know, it wasn't the same kid from high school that thought he was the shit because he played basketball and football and stuff. And like it was now, like look at me. I help a lot of people. I know the book a little bit, like all this cool stuff. And I got to a place that was just as dark because I was not serving God. I was serving myself, and I was continuing to run the show in different areas of my life. It just looked different than it had prior. And eventually it took me to a place of brokenness, and I, you know, got a new sponsor, and I went through some of that work, and like things started to change. And you know, what I want to talk about is essentially, like I said before, this whole thing is about connecting to some sort of power that can free me from the obsession. You know, having an experience with whatever it is that you want to call God. Short of that, like, I'm not good. Like, I'm not going to stay sober. My experience shows abundantly. On my own, I cannot stay sober. So what I want to talk about is the central life of my, or central fact of my life today. What it says in the book, for those of you that don't know, there's 4 facts and there's a solution. The first fact is, the fact is that for reasons yet obscure, alcoholics have lost choice in drink. I'm very, very clear on that. I do not have the power of choice in drink. I cannot wake up in the morning and make a decision to not smoke crack. The decision that I'm left with today is, do I want to take the spiritual approach? Do I want to do the spiritual disciplines that are, you know, necessary of me to stay connected to this power that's freed me from the obsession? Or do I want to die an alcoholic death? Those are my options. the second fact is the tremendous fact that we have found a common solution. That common solution is God. Our way out is the 12 steps. The third fact is the great fact is that because of that common solution, we have had deep and vital spiritual experiences. And then the fourth fact is the one that I want to talk about. The central fact of my life today is that that a loving creator has entered into my heart and lives in a way which is indeed miraculous. Because here's the thing, man. When I came into the rooms of Cocaine Anonymous, what you guys had to offer me had to be just as good, if not better, than what heroin had to offer me out there, where I wasn't sticking around. I wasn't sticking around. So what I want to essentially do, Bill Wilson says, it's our chief responsibility to pull the newcomer with a vision of what sobriety could be like. And I, you know, so many times I went into a discussion meeting where we're bitching about our problems, and I hear about some kid's roommate at his halfway house stealing his peanut butter, and I'm like, there's no solution here. I wasn't pulled with a vision. And, you know, I came in like I destroyed everything. I ran my life into the ground. And Bill Wilson says that the reason this works is 2 reasons. 1, a lot of people recovered. I don't want to have the whole recovering debate. What I'll tell you is that the book says recovered 31 times. It says recovering once, and it's in the family afterwards. And it's talking about a newcomer. And at the time, a newcomer was somebody that was still on a hospital bed. I've recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. And all that means is that I have been freed from the obsession to drink. It does not mean that I am cured of alcoholism. I am not. 50 Cent, shot 9 times. You know, he's on his album cover wearing a bulletproof vest. He has recovered from those initial injuries. Does that mean he can't get shot again? Does he think he's bulletproof? Absolutely not. You know, if I stop doing the spiritual practices that are required of me to stay sober, I promise all of you I will be out on Dixie in a hotel somewhere smoking crack again. The only thing that keeps me sober is a relationship with a power greater than myself. And that's the first reason that a lot of people recover. The second reason is that it reunites homes. And I'll say this, like my dad left when I was 2, I was sexually abused when I was 2, that stuff's whatever, it's not the reason I'm an alcoholic or a drug addict. But I had like a loving home. I grew up in a home with my mom and my grandma, and then my stepdad moved in a couple years later. And they were happy, joyous, and free, man. Like they taught me morals, they taught me like all this stuff that I'm supposed to know as a child, I just couldn't apply them. And the fact is like, there were no sleepless nights before I started getting high. There was no arguing, there was no yelling in the house, there was no undesirables in the home. Like, I picked those things up, and I brought them into the house, and I infected the people around me until they were as sick as I was coming in here. And I had destroyed every relationship with the only people that actually cared about me. Prior to coming to you guys. And like, it was absolutely, absolutely miserable. Like I said, man, like, I absolutely love my mother. You know, like, I don't know what it is. I'm a mama's boy. A lot of people know that. And, like, she came down here a few months ago to give me my 2-year medallion, and she told you guys, like, I used to sleep with my phone on my shoulder because I was certain that I was going to get a call that Cameron was dead. She used to pray that I would wake up in jail just so that she would know that I was safe. That I was safe, you know. And someone said to me very early on, a mother is only as happy as her sickest child. And that stuck with me. And like, I went through this process and I watched these promises of recovering from that seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. Like I said, when I sit up here, man, I'm talking about permanent recovery. I'm talking about never ever having to pick up a needle or a crack pipe again. I'm not talking about one day at a time. Like, obviously the practices are one day at a time, but I'm talking about it. We have a solution that is absolutely permanent. That I could spend my last breaths on earth completely sober as a result of this program and as a result of connecting to that power that frees me from the obsession to drink and continuing to do those things daily. And then I got to watch my family come back together. So, essential fact of my life today, a few months ago, I I went to, it's like a bunch of different stuff happening once. My family was adopting two 16-year-old boys from Ukraine, and I wanted to go see them. Well, let me rewind a little bit. When I'm like 6 months sober, I hadn't seen my mother sober in years. I had not been able to show up as a son to her for so incredibly long. And I remember the opportunity presented itself for me to hop on a plane and go up and spend some time with them on her birthday and to be there as a son, which I was never able to do. And I was lit up for AA at the time. I was sponsoring a bunch of people. I was reading a bunch of like history books. I was studying. I was doing all this stuff. And I'm on the plane to go see my mom finally. And like, I remember I'm sitting next to this lady and like the sun's setting and we're pulling into the landing pad or whatever it's called. And I'm reading AA Coming of Age. And as I'm reading it, it's the point where Bill is outside the Mayflower Hotel and he's about to call Dr. Bob and he hasn't called yet. And for those of you that don't know, like, he's outside, he knows he has to help somebody. He's calling a bunch of people and he can't get through to anyone. And he's about to call Dr. Bob. And I remember, like, I don't know what it was. It was one of those overwhelming God moments where like, It just took over me. And like, there were tears coming down my face, and I was reading it, and the lady next to me was looking at me like, I'm absolutely crazy. And I remember thinking, like, make the call. Like, come on, Bill, make the call. I'm like cheering him on in my mind. Because what Bill didn't know is that he makes that phone call, and I get to see my mother. I get to have the relationship back with my mom. He didn't know that at the time. And what that tells me is I never, ever know the importance of that next service event. So when I'm sitting at home and I'm chilling with my boys and I don't want to answer my phone for a sponsee, like, answer the phone. Because I don't know how important that's going to be. Some kid 30 years from now could need to see his mom. Could need to see his mom. And all I do is plant seeds and I let God water those. But how incredibly selfish of me to not suit up and show up when that's what the people that brought me in here and to the place of absolute freedom did for me. You know, so a couple months ago, they're adopting these kids and I want to go up and surprise them. I just got a new car. It's not a new car, it was new to me, and I'm going to like go on a road trip to surprise them. They go on vacation every year to Indiana, and I'm like planning all this stuff. I know absolutely nothing about cars. Prior to that, like, this is all happening at the same time, I used to play poker as my job, and I call my sponsor, and I'm like, what do you think about this, blah, blah, blah. He asked me the questions for Gamblers Anonymous, that kind of stuff, and he's like, I don't look at basketball players and think they're addicted to basketball. I'm not suggesting anyone in here go play poker, but I went to the casino. I was going to the casino to play this tournament, and my car breaks down like half a mile from the casino. So like any good drug addict, I went and played the tournament. I was like, I'll deal with this later. And I ended up winning the tournament for like $1,200. And what happened was the alternator went out. No idea about cars. And keep in mind, I'm planning to go on this big road trip. So obviously I need my car to be in shape. So what happens is I get it towed back, which costs like $250 because it was all the way in Lauderdale. And they replace the alternator. Next day the battery goes out. They replace that. Then it needs an oil change. And then something else. I had to get like a new tire or something. The cost of what it cost to fix my car was exactly what I won at the poker tournament. You chalk that up as coincidence. So then, also, like I said, I know nothing about cars. Everything is fixed on my car for me to go. Like the day before I leave for this road trip to visit my mom. So I leave. Everything goes smoothly. I'm driving up to Georgia for AA Worlds. And on the way there, I was supposed to go with two people that were supposed to fly in. I'm about 15 minutes from a place called New Smyrna on my way up there, and my friend calls me that was supposed to already be there, and he was like, hey man, I missed my flight, like, I don't think I'm going to be able to make it, and he's like, I was like, listen dude, like, I'm 15 minutes from your house right now, I can come pick you up and we can go. Perfect timing, you know, God's timing. And I grabbed him. We went up to AA Worlds, which if anybody has the opportunity to go, go. It happens once every 5 years. When we talk about the spiritual malady, we talk about a disconnection from God, self, and others. I've never felt more connected to those three things than I did at AA Worlds. 60,000 people in one, you know, stadium with a common purpose of helping that person that's still in a hotel on Dixie smoking crack and cannot for the life of them figure a way out. You know, that's why we're here. I went there, I had a beautiful experience, I drove up, and on the day of my 2-year anniversary, I got to see my family, I got to see my mother and surprise them and meet my new brothers from Ukraine, and just an absolutely another beautiful God moment. And what happens is I leave, I come back to Florida, I make the drive down here, and about an hour after I get back, it was my 2-year anniversary, I was going to be celebrating a couple days later at Pompano. An hour after I get back, I get a phone call from my mom. She said, hey, me, your brothers, and your sister are on our way down, I want to give you your medallion. And I get down here, and they get down here, and we, you know, she comes and she gives me my medallion, and it's absolutely beautiful, and I have this amazing experience with my family where I was, you know, I was never able to show up as a son before. Like, my little sister is indebted to Cocaine Anonymous, and she doesn't even know it. She has a brother today, thanks to you guys. Thanks to the rooms like these that took me in and showed me exactly what the solution was, that I could get my family back, I could get my life back, I could get all of these things. And the day after I picked up my medallion, I was spending time in prayer and meditation. And again, this has nothing to do with me, man. Like, this is all God. Because a kid like me 2 years ago never would have thought of anything like this. And the thought came in. One of my roommates and one of my best friends was picking up his 1-year medallion the following week here. And his sister, who has 2 years, was going to present it to him. And they're very, very close with their mother. And she couldn't make it down because of the financial situations. And I was like, the thought came to me, like, you should get them a plane ticket. Like, I've been blessed enough, financially speaking, that there was no issue like that. And actually, this thought came in, like, you should get them a plane ticket. Like, call her mom and do it. And what happened is we surprised her. Well, we brought her down and surprised them. And he didn't even know. A lot of you guys were in here, and he was up here about to pick up his year, and she's going to give it to him. And she's like, I'm not giving it to him. And his mom walked in, and it was just absolutely beautiful. The night before that, I spoke at a halfway house in Pompano. And there's one kid there that got a white chip, and I'm the kind of guy that I've got, like, laser vision for the people that have white chips, and I always talk to him after the meeting. And he had just relapsed, and he was like, when's the next time you're speaking, man? And I was like, I speak at Pompano every Wednesday night. And he's like, I'm going to come check it out. And the night that he came to check it out was the night that that kid got his medallion from his mother. And he went up to this kid's mom after the meeting and said, like, hey, like, my mom's really struggling. I've been doing this for years. Do you think that you could talk to her? They still talk today on a daily basis. Me speaking at that halfway house had nothing to do with me. It had nothing to do with that kid. It had to do with those two mothers connecting so that there could be some healing there through God. I never know what that next service commitment is going to be. It has absolutely nothing to do with me. My job as a member of Cocaine Anonymous or Alcoholics Anonymous is to suit up and show up. What it says on page 102 of the Big Book is that my job now is to be at the place where I can be of maximum service to God and to my fellows. And that's not a geographical place. It's a place spiritually and mentally. Because what I can promise you is a kid like me does not do stuff like that. I just don't. I don't suit up and show up. I don't go, you know, out of my way to sponsor people and do these things. It has nothing to do with me. I'll share one real quick story with you, and I'll stop. I remember I was probably 3 months sober at the time, 4 months sober. I was sponsoring, and one of my sponsees, invited me over to dinner with his family, and he wanted me to meet his family and stuff, and I go in, and like, his mom is like, are you Cameron? And, like, you could tell her eyes lit up, and she was, like, happy to see me, and, like, I was so shocked. I'm, like, looking around, like, yeah, that's me. That's me. And I went through dinner, and it was a beautiful experience. And I remember I was driving home that night, and the reason that I was so overwhelmed in that moment is because I realized that the Cameron that she was talking about was not the same Cameron that I had tried to kill for the last 23 years. You know, it wasn't the same Cameron that I looked in the mirror and just absolutely hated over and over and over again. And again, that's as no result of my own. You know what? It's just connecting to that power and having that relationship. I say it all the time. Like, if you're in here and you're one of the kids like me that just came in and out and went to meetings and stuff, like, get a sponsor. Get into the work. Do the stuff that's going to free you from the obsession. Because the real thing is, like, I'm not going to get high because of what I don't know. I'm going to get high because of what I don't feel. And if I come in here and I don't do the necessary things required of me to have that experience, I'm not going to feel it. And eventually what will happen is I'll go on another run. You know, if it wasn't for rooms like these and people like you guys, I would have missed my entire fucking life. So thank you guys.